Watching a rocket launch is fascinating and nerve-wracking. Watching how the rocket lifts off, defying gravity, just gives us a glimpse of the complexity and the dangers of this endeavor. As it disappears in the sky, we turn off the transmission and then keep going with our lives, with our own challenges. Some of us might continue watching what is happening with those missions, the mission activities, more if they are novel or happen for the first time. But then people, a few days after, weeks or even months after, remember that someone was up there when we hear that they are coming back. This second or last phase of what is a space flight is what I want to focus on. It's not as spectacular, probably because we cannot see each step of the way, and we don't appreciate the dangers and the critical of many of these steps. But they are very important and also very interesting, and that's why I want to share them with you. In this case, I will use the recent return of the Axiom 3 mission as an example of how it works. The return story begins probably after the crew loads the Dragon capsule with all the experiments and hardware that they are going to bring back. Then after this, if they are returning immediately, then it's followed by the astronauts putting their spacesuits and checking the procedures for the undocking and landing parameters that are given by the ground crew. From this point forward, the Dragon crew maintains close communication with the ground support teams, which will follow every step the crew execute and every activity that requires human intervention. Because the US portion of the ISS is managed by NASA, the Johnson Space Center in Houston and SpaceX in Hawthorne, California, follow closely the undocking event. Once the hatch of the Dragon capsule and the ISS are closed, the capsule starts the depressurization. This process takes about 1 hour, after which the Dragon capsule autonomously will undock. But before this can happen, the Dragon crew and the ground support confirm it is safe to detach at the scheduled time. In this case, the time is selected very careful to ensure that there is communication through all the return trip and for the capsule to reach safely the landing site. The undocking starts when SpaceX gives the call and the astronauts lower their spacesuit visors, and the Dragon capsule autonomously starts undocking procedures. The first step is retracting the umbilical, which has given power to the Dragon capsule when it was docked. The second step is releasing the 12 hooks of Dragon that maintain the hard docking with the ISS. At this point, the ISS and the Dragon capsule start separation. Soon after, and to broaden this separation, the Dragon executes two of its four departure burns. The first lasting just 60 seconds, and the second, that is about 3.5 minutes after, lasting just about 21 seconds. These burns will take the Dragon capsule out of the keep out sphere and the approach ellipsoid, both of which are imaginary ellipses that demark safety zones. The first is about 200 meters from the ISS, while the second, with dimensions 4 kilometers by 2 kilometers by 2 kilometers, is centered in the ISS. This cannot be crossed by any visiting spacecraft that has not completed the safety procedures defined by NASA. These procedures are defined to keep the ISS safe from any accident during docking or undocking maneuvers. All these maneuvers that the Dragon executes are done autonomously. So after crossing the keep out sphere, the astronauts are cleared to remove their suits, which they will not put again until before they are starting with the deorbiting phase. The last two burns put the capsule in the right orientation to follow the planned trajectory. After the capsule clears the approach ellipsoid, NASA Johnson Space Center hands over the mission follow-up to SpaceX, which will keep in touch with the crew through the remaining hours of the flight. And the duration of this phase between leaving the approach ellipsoid and the starting of the deorbit depend on many factors, including the location of the ISS at the time of the undocking and the selecting landing site. During the last hours of the flight, in the case of Axiom 3 was 40 hours, Dragon continues moving into the position for reentry, executing several downhill phase burn firings of the Dragon Draco thrusters and adjusting the spacecraft's orbit. through all the time before initiating the deorbiting phase, the whole SpaceX ground crew monitors the capsule systems and are available to answer any questions from the astronauts, but in general, leave them free to do whatever they want to do. However, about 1 hour before the splashdown, the astronauts and the ground crew of SpaceX reestablish what is formal communications and together review and confirm each of the steps that will bring the crew safely back home. At this point, the astronauts will have put their space suits and sound in their positions. The ground crew will continue monitoring all the systems and the capsule, the weather in the landing site, and coordinated with the recovery crew that will be recovering the capsule after the splashdown. Several autonomous tasks continue happening while the crew is traveling to the reentry location, like isolating the thermal control system fluid loops from the radiator, which will help to keep the thermal temperature of the Dragon capsule and the temperature of the spacesuits of the crew comfortable during reentry. This is followed by the claws separation. The claws are connecting the trunk to the capsule and delivering power, telemetry, and fluids to the Dragon capsule. The claw separation is the first step in the trunk separation and jetting zone. The trunk is actually the cylindrical and unpressurized part of the spacecraft that has the solar arrays and which has maintained power to the capsule since it left the ISS. It will fall to Earth and will burn during re-entry. Once the trunk is separated, Dragon runs entirely on battery power. The separation also reveals the bottom section of the Dragon capsule where the heat shield is located. The next step uses the Dragon Forward Dragon thrusters that are located in the cone section of the Dragon. These perform an deorbit burn and put the capsule in the precise trajectory to the splashdown zone, in this case off the coast of Daytona, Florida. Once completed and not needed anymore, the cone that protects the forward bulkhead closes and locks in preparation for re-entry. The deorbit phase lasts about 9 minutes, where the vehicle will orient to enter safely the atmosphere and start slowing down from orbital velocity, which is approximately 17,500 miles per hour. The friction of the spacecraft pushing through the air at high speeds builds up a layer of super hot plasma around this vehicle. This plasma reaches about 3,500 Fahrenheit in temperature, mainly felt by the heating shield at the bottom of the capsule. Most of us might have experienced this horrible life phase in the movies. However, I'm sure it will be equally spectacular and frightening to see it for real. The hot plasma phase lasts about 7 minutes, resulting in a loss of communication with the crew, sometimes referred as LOS or loss of signal. When SpaceX reestablishes communication with the Dragon capsule, the speed is about 350 miles per hour. Since the Axiom 3 landing was during the daytime, this is when we could start seeing the capsule appear in the sky. It becomes evident once the parachutes deploy about 2 minutes later, and those will slow down the Dragon capsule to 50 miles per hour. At this speed, the vehicle would experience a soft splashdown on the ocean. The first set of parachutes we see is a pair called the drop parachutes. These are two small parachutes designed to stabilize the Dragon capsule and begin to slowing down. Less than a minute later, at about 6,500 feet of altitude and while traveling at about 119 miles per hour, four main parachutes deploy. These are the big orange and white parachutes that further slow down the vehicle over the course of 3 minutes. The splashdown occurs in a predefined location where the recovery team are prepositioned to retrieve the Dragon capsule immediately. The recovery process also is carefully planned. For Axiom 3, the recovery vessel, Shannon, and the recovery crew came to pick them up after the splashdown. The whole process can take about 30 minutes, starting with two fast boats reaching the Dragon capsule. This ground crew performs some ordnance and hyperal checks, ensuring that the vehicle is safe to approach, and they also climb onto the capsule and begin rigging operations to prepare it to be lifted onto the recovery vessel. While this vessel arrives, the ground crew also ensures that the area and the vehicle are safe to continue those hoisting operations. Simultaneously, SpaceX ground crew also recovers the parachutes. Inside the capsule, the commander and the pilot keep monitoring the vehicle and stay in contact with the ground crew. During this time, the crew might also have their private medical conference, or PMC, with a SpaceX medical. Once ready to lift Dragon, the hydraulic lift in the recovery vessel goes down and slowly starts bringing closer to the capsule and starts lifting into the deck to the recovery vessel or nest. After doing some more safety checks, the capsule then is moved toward the egress platform. The recovery crew then opens the side hatch and puts protective tools to ensure that the crew is safe when they egress the vehicle. The recruit crew then enters the capsule and helps each of the astronauts exit the capsule, where the medical team will be ready to help them and also do the first medical check. After it is complete, the astronauts will catch a helicopter flight back to shore, where they will transfer to a waiting aircraft ready to take them to Houston. And this concludes the story of the return of a spacecraft from the ISS to Earth.